is supposed to be where this country was founded, right here. That's what history says. That's what they promote across this state. They got pictures of the Indians setting fish traps here. And we're still trapping the same fish 400 plus years later. And let's say we hadn't got them all yet. We're not that good. It's impossible.
You're a commercial fisherman?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
I'm Joe Wilson. I was born on this island. Four brothers, four sisters. Four of the five brothers all hold master's license. In other words, we've been on a boat ever since, just like my little boy, since we were born. Just, when you live on an island, you understand a little bit about the water. It's kind of like growing up on a farm. You're going to know a little bit about farming.
Something that's unique about commercial fishing is we're giving access to people. We don't have money for a charter boat or money to own a boat. And so I feel like it's very important. We're blessed here in North Carolina. It's just our problem is I don't feel like that my state stands up for us of what we do. And it gives our fisheries away to the feds. When the feds say do something, the state of North Carolina says how high you need me to jump.
Fishery management is a very touchy subject because rather than manage fish, regulators regulate the men who fish.
I think when I started back in 87 on a different boat, I had to have one license, a captain's license. And I think now it's up to 23, 24, 25 different permits, licenses, pieces of paper, drug testing that's required of us now. It may be more than that. But that somewhere in there, Dolphin Wahoo card, Southeast NOAA fisheries, National Marine Fisheries permits. The state now is three or four or five different things we need from the state. That's grown exponentially. So that's when we started paying attention back in 2003 or four when they tried to implement a recreational fishing license. At that point, I had no idea how much regulation we were really under or the people. You wouldn't think there would be a group against fishermen, but the more you would pay attention to it, the more you would see that it is true, and there are people against commercial fishermen.
You look at how fishermen have been portrayed for years. You can look merely in the movies, and movies and popular media represent fishermen because they've been painted in that particular light. You know, they're out there, they're just basically pirates of the sea, they're, you know, all of these particular things. So you sully the person that you're trying to influence. And that's basically what we've been fighting for a number of years here in the state of North Carolina, as we deal with state issues in regards to fisheries, as we deal with federal issues in regards to fisheries. And you know, we're no different than a farmer, we're no different than a coal miner, we're no different than a timber man, a logger. You know, we don't want zero regulation. There has to be some regulation in order to make sure that there's not a disparity in the playing field.
We've already been cut back on the production of what, when I was 15 or 20 years old, run through right here at this fish house. We don't even catch a fraction of what we were catching back in the 70s or the 80s. The landings don't lie. Just, we don't even, there's no way we're bothering it now if we didn't catch them then. If we didn't wipe them out then, it's impossible for us to do it now. This whole basin was solid trawlboats. Rafted off across the whole creek, wasn't it? There was more landed in here in one 24-hour period then than is even packed in here now basically the whole winter.
Oh, absolutely.
That's how much we've been reduced, and they're still hollering, we're going to get them all.
Those people out there that want our waters for their playground are the problem.
That's a small
and the
fraction.
The elected officials that they go to try to get what they want or the next problem.
Back when the recreational fishing license was trying to be passed, I was explaining to state elected officials that we're all basically revenue producing. It's all commercial. Basically, all of it is. We're taking a public trust resource and we're getting money for it. You know, if I go out there and on a charter and I catch two fish and they give me $800, I've sold the fish. So we're using public trust waterways. It's all revenue producing. It's all commercial. Money is changing hands, going from here to there. A lot of people want to say commercial fishing is just catching them in a net and selling them. Yeah, that's basically commercial fishing, yes. But I believe a charter headboat, anybody taking people for hire, is also commercial. And then I don't know how you can say Bob coming down here on vacation and going to a tackle store, buying some stuff, going out on the beach and fishing. They say it's recreational fishing, but I mean it's all part of the process of revenue producing and using the public trust for profit, which is what is great about North Carolina. That's why we try not to badmouth recreational fishing. We need it all. We need people coming down here, spending money, buying a surf rod, going surf fishing, going to a restaurant, eating fresh caught local seafood. It's all part of the big picture.
Has there been a significant battle basically between recreational and commercial?
Or there's always been a battle between the recreational elites wanting to ban gill nets and the fish when they're already catching all the majority of them. There's always, but you'll never hear of the commercial man saying, I want you gone, or we need to ban them, or not. You don't hear that. So when people talk about the, well, not only the battle, but the conflict. A conflict, you got to have two sides.
You can't compare the recreational fishermen here to the ones in Charlotte. It's a little different. It's a whole different bubble. Like I say now, every youngin' here sits on this dock in the afternoons, they'll get in on their bicycle, ride down, go fishing, and when they come 14 years old, get on a charter boat, which is commercial. If there's money involved, it's commercial, and continue into some form of fishery, and if you're doing it for a living, then you're commercial at it. So it doesn't matter how they're catching them. Somebody else is determining whether it's recreational or commercial. It's commercial 100% for me, but I like to catch them. So is that recreational because I like it?
About what commercial fishing is and what they do. I know people say the heritage of it. Yes, it's been going on for 400 years here. That's part of it, but it's ingrained in the culture and in each individual village's society. Wade, Salva, Ananthe, Hatteras, Ocracoke, down east. It's really what these people love to do and what they depend on doing, and it's what floats their communities. That in itself is wonderful in that they're not asking for anything but just to go to work. And then you have someone from the western part of the state or from other states coming to North Carolina saying, you know, what you're doing is really no good. It's not very noble. You're killing everything. We need these fish so we can have recreational dollars spent here. It's got to be very disheartening. I've met a lot of them. I know a lot of people that do commercial fish and net fish here within 100 miles of us. But to hear those people come out here and say that without living here and knowing what's going on is really what's gotten a lot of us going to try to educate the rest of the state.
We're one of the last states that has gill netting really in our state, in our inland waters. And that's also where the some of your elitist recreational groups, particularly the CCA and others, you know, go out fishing. In every other state south of us, pretty much, and in the Gulf, they have banned gill nets.
1888, 1889, somewhere in there is when they started trying to put net fishermen out of business in Texas. Texas sent people down to the Gulf to study it. They took senators and their assemblymen down there to look at it in the 20s and 30s, and they said, man, these guys are just hardworking, leave them alone. And so, and they studied it and studied it and studied it. Then the big money started rolling in 1970s. And to tie in something he said earlier about the CCA, and then in the 1970s, that's when all that money, and that's when the PR situation turned against commercial fishermen. That's when they started purchasing advertisement in newspapers, advertisement in sport fishing magazines. saying how the commercial fishermen were wiping everything out and printing untruths. But that was when the whole PR propaganda machine for, you know, pro recreational fishing got started.
The game plan when the CCA moves into the history of the CCA is move into a state and create a gill net ban. They declare a fish a game fish. That is not saying you can't go set your nets. It's saying you can't catch this particular fish. Well, that's not going to be the way of it. Some of those fish are going to get caught. Well, ultimately, they will go crying, look how many of our game fish they're catching, and there will be a complete gill net ban. That's happened in Texas, Florida. They got a stronghold in South Carolina. But the proof of all this lies within that book, Wetlands Ride, by Robert Fritchie. That is the history and formation of the Coastal Conservation Association. It was actually formed by a man named Walter Fondren.
The Fondren family owned Exxon, and it's hard to fight that kind of money. That kind of money buys a lot of influence.
When George Bush Jr. signed the bill that made rockfish illegal outside of 3 miles, Walter Fondren was there with him. And George Bush made the statement, Walter Fondren is a great conservationist.
Foreign fish is cheaper and it's taking over the U.S. market. 80% of all seafood sold in the U.S. is now imported. The FDA inspects and tests less than 1% of all seafood imports. And when it does, it frequently finds filthy fish and banned chemicals. FDA records show page after page of rejected shipments. Catfish from China, veterinary drugs. Swordfish from Vietnam, poisonous. Snapper from Malaysia, filthy.
If it's from a foreign country, I'd be very cautious. I wouldn't eat it.
Ron Sparks knows what can be found in foreign fish. As Alabama's Commissioner of Agriculture, he's been to Vietnam and witnessed fish farmed in sewage. Sparks has ordered extensive testing of fish imports in Alabama, one of the few states with a seafood safety testing program. 50 to 60% of all fish imports in Alabama are rejected.
One of the things often found in this imported fish is a fungicide called malachite green. It's illegal to use in food because it causes cancer and birth defects.
Lab testers say fish farmers in nations like China play a cat and mouse game with them. When the lab rejects shipments for an illegal chemical, foreign fish farmers simply switch to another harmful chemical.
They know it's illegal, they know it hurts people, but they do it anyway.
When you buy it at home, very expensive. I try to do freshwater fish here, not farm fish. Extremely expensive.
Chicken for me.
You're dealing with a chasm that can't be connected right now because the National Marine Fisheries Service, whose parent is NOAA, National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, is funded by the Salt and Straw Kennedy Act, which is basically, it was a tariff that was imposed on imported seafood. And you can look, within 3 years, the percentage of imported seafood went from about 15% to about 75% in the course of 3 years once that fund was changed. So the more seafood we import, the greater the funding for National Marine Fisheries Service and NOAA. So it was a negative negative.
The sturgeon was listed by NOAA, an arm under that's National Marine Fisheries Service. So they determined that they needed to list the sturgeon on the endangered species list. Well, everybody up and down the state, up and down the coast, which is under this Atlantic States, they were just like baffled. They were like, there's no way. In Menhaden, the science that they chose to reduce it by 20%, there was no science for reducing it by 20%. The enviros wanted 50,
the Atlantic states chose 20.
Just because of basically the King's decree, Bush said that, you know, we can't harvest them outside of 3 miles. That was an executive order. So the federal government at this present moment is spending millions of dollars a day to patrol a 3 mile line in Virginia. I'm talking about C-130s, Hercules helicopters, cutters, 44 footers, Zodiacs, undercover boats. I mean, you could bring a load of dope in quicker than you could catch a striped bass outside that 3 mile line.
There's more drum out there than there's ever been right now. And so about our fisheries and these prohibitions is what we see out on the sound or in the ocean, a lot of times don't jive with what they're telling us in stock assessments.
This is a computer that we have to have. We have a transponder on every boat that we have. And okay, here you see, that's the name of my boats. That one there, he's right there. He's at the inlet waiting to come in for the channel. We got it here. All these are our boats. See, all right, right here. I'm gonna pull up on the Vicky too. Click on it. She's off of Toms River, New Jersey. She's 80. See, where's it? See, yeah. See where? She's 87 miles off the shore. She's going up there to catch the flounders because we have to use a turtle shooter down here before we can catch flounders. And and you lose 40% of your catch because of the turtle shooter. When they come in there, they see them bars and it flips them right out, shoots them out. Mm-hmm. North Carolina is the only state that's got to have that, and parts of it, a little bit of Virginia. And this is okay.
So they make you do that because they're worried that turtles are in danger.
Yes, and see, the turtles are endangered species, but there's so many turtles here. This has been 30 years.
When something's listed under an Endangered Species Act, you can't touch it, look at it, sniff it, talk about it. I mean, you know, I'm just kind of going on a little bit, but you can't.
There's not a beach, I think, from Maryland or maybe Connecticut, all the way to the Mexico-Texas border. There is not a beach in the southeast United States that is not patrolled every morning, I think starting in April or May, for turtle crawls. This has been for the last 25 years. Every morning now, if there is a crawl and they see a nest and they go protect the nest, they mark it off, everything's, then they know how many days until they're going to come back out. Then when they come out, they put little fences up and they make sure all the turtles get down to the water. They fence them off and there's been raccoon killings, possum killings, fox killings, they kill ghost crabs. Everything they can do to ensure that the turtle makes it to the water. I'm sure there's a lot of them that don't survive once they get to the water, but now 100% get to the water. Where out of 100, maybe 10 used to get to the water. So, and then everybody wants to know why there's so many turtles now. And I've never ever seen so many in the past 2 or 3 years, but now that for 25 years they've been doing this, and now there are turtles everywhere. And people don't understand why that is. I mean, there's more people fishing, there's more nets, how come there's more turtles? That is the reason why there are more turtles.
You know, a commercial fisherman can't touch a turtle, you know that? We're not certified. You got to be certified. You know, if he's in the water and you take your hand, that's the interaction. So if you got a net out there and you got a turtle into it, what are you going to do?
If you don't do these observations, and you're over your tank, they can shut you down, the feds, under this endangered species. That's why we jump through these hoops. But the feds have never told us, nor has our state demanded on a letterhead, official letter that says, hey, where's the end game? When are you going to do a stock assessment? Where do we have to get to?
North Carolina Aquarium, turtle deal. I wish I had a copy of their newsletter. Print it out. From middle of December to middle of January, record turtles stranded, washed up, died. December and January, I went right to the aquarium. I said, who printed this? We did. Is it accurate? Oh, yes. I said, so now let me get this straight. You're hollering the turtles are in danger, but you're printing and putting out to the public that record numbers come to the shore, and the months are not supposed to be here, in water temperatures they're not supposed to be in, and against the wind. How many is there? If you're broadcasting, how many records you're breaking when they ain't even supposed to be here? Old colored man looked at me, busted out laughing, said, ain't nobody else looked at it like that. I said, how the hell else can you look at it? You're preaching that there's record numbers. And everybody still hollering, send your money, send your donations so we can save them. That's what we're dealing with.
You know what would be better? I said, you know what, we need, if you really wanted to save the turtles, if you wanted to help things, take the fishermen, train them how to handle a turtle, how to get them, how to take care of them. Have Harvey use a refuge. So when you, if you had a turtle that was injured, what do? You bring him in and keep him into the water and send him to Miss Beasley. And you know what she said? She said that she would, if they take the turtles to her and she brings them back to where they are and releases them, we'll get 60% more turtles. Which is, hey, win, win, win.
You know, all the bureaucrats love to have to go through the process, but the process takes forever. You know, our state should have said, wait a second, feds, we're going to sue you because we don't believe it should have been listed under an Endangered Species Act, because we have to jump through all these hoops. They go along or wait the process out 2 or 3 years. That fisherman who's had his flounder reduction or net reduction because of nothing else but being listed, he doesn't have, we ain't got 2 or 3 years to wait. I mean, you know.
But what happened was, he's using that to implement rules and regulations for the commercial fishermen. So he cut us back to only four nights. We could only set our nets 4 nights. We're having 7 days a week. 4 nights we could only have 1,200 yards of webbing. And you got to be, you got to set the net 2 hours before sundown. And 2 hours after sundown, you got to have it up, out of the water, bring it back. But then you have to go back at night, at evening, to set it back. Look what he's caused.
It's an intentional device used to cripple an industry.
It can't be no worse for, I mean, in our industry, the different things happening as far as, you know, the different fisheries and just not only at the federal level of what happens to fish due to us, but at the state level with this Marine Fisheries Commission. I mean, it's an important thing.
The Marine Fisheries Commission, I used to go to every meeting back in 2004, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 4 meetings a year. We would try to go to all of them, but it just became futile because they were going to pass whatever they wanted to pass. And it just became a waste of time because of the agenda, and it's been something that's happened slowly over time. It's just not one horrible thing. The recreational fishing license was really pretty bad and crippling. But everything else they do is such small increments that it's hard for, if you tell a senator, see, look what they just did. He said, well, that doesn't seem like it's that bad. I said, well, yeah, but they just did this one before, and this the one before, and this 2 years before that. And everything they do piles up. And just as an example, you know, net attendance, you have to be with your net. Times when you can set your net. Times when the net's got to be out of the water. Days that you can fish, days you can't fish. So all of these things have been to appease really the recreational side, or the CCA, that does not want to have nets in the water, thinks that they're the worst thing in the world.
I've been very involved in fishery politics for a long period of time, and it's been very hard to put our thumb on the exact circumstances surrounding fishery management. But what's happened is the feds used to be here and the state used to be here. Flip forward to today, and you see a federal government that wants all of the states lined up underneath them, and the way that they have impacted that is they hire people in regulatory agencies away from the state. They let them stay in the state, they let them get their retirement, you know, get their pension, get all of that, and then whoosh, the federal government hires them away. So these particular people are getting pensions, they're getting, you know, money from states that come from taxes. And then they go to work for the federal government, and they go back into the agencies, and they go back into the state bureaucracies in which they had been for entrenched for 20 years or 25 years or 30 years, however long it took them to get their full pension. And they know all of the people, they know all of the tricks, they know how everything is set up, and they mold it to the federal government and what the federal government wants. And that, in a microcosm, is what's happened to the fisheries in North Carolina.
Folks, we're here today to do an interview with Dr. Lewis Daniel for ncwaterman.com. Dr. Daniel, let's address this and get it clear for folks once and for all. The North Carolina Division of Marine Fisheries, you and your staff provide recommendations and data for the Marine Fisheries Commission in the state of North Carolina. You and your staff are not in the regulatory equation, but you do enforce those regulations once they come down from the Marine Fisheries Commission in the state of North Carolina by statute. That is correct, is it not?
That's correct. We make the recommendations. We consolidate the science. We work with our advisory panels and other public to develop fishery management plans, and then the Marine Fisheries Commission reviews and approves those plans.
Fisheries in the state of North Carolina is the only wild animal that the sole authority for opening season and closing season rests with one man.
He just shut down speckled trout because they've had a stun or a freeze. So now the season for speckled trout is closed until June. Because speckled trout is a very water temperature oriented thing.
Cold stun dead fish, I'm sure a lot of turtles were cold stun too.
Now they close it all down now. People were scooping up fish that were dead. They stopped them from doing it. Won't let you pick them up dead.
You can't even pick them up that are dead and sell them. It closes everything to recreational, charter boats, and commercial guys that, you know, that will just scoop them up and, well, I can get $20 for these fish here, and you can't do it now. So it's just for the birds and crabs to eat, I guess.
I think this is the first time we've ever had ice. This has been going on for hundreds and thousands of years. Guess what? We still got them. They've been going south for 4 months. This is the ones that wasn't even supposed to be here, the leftovers. The bulk of them are way south of here, and it didn't freeze. But that shows you management right there. That's how thick they were, and they didn't even know it.
Or weren't willing to acknowledge it.
Exactly.
It's common sense. Nothing in the fisheries is common sense. It's science, and it's no science. It's nothing to it. It's
junk science.
It's lies.
The stock assessment, the models that they use to determine the biomass of a particular fishery is something that's come up with by a man. There's countless models. There's millions of models that they could use. But every model they use is always the one that doesn't show anything. They're not just not close to where the particular fishery that they're trying to prove or disprove or just to show the stock status. They're miles and miles and miles away from it.
Dr. Daniel, the North Carolina Division of Marine Fisheries is well respected for the data that they provide to the Marine Fisheries Commission in the state of North Carolina, probably one of the most respected states, along with Louisiana, to provide that type of fisheries data. Would you address the accuracy and the truthfulness of that data?
You know, my history in fisheries management going back to graduate school was in quality data, quality information, being able to create master's theses and PhD dissertations that met peer review and scrutiny. My staff is the same way. We take great pride in the quality and the quantity of data that we collect on both the recreational and the commercial fishery.
Hi guys, attached is Jeff Gearhart's hooking mortality study that we discussed yesterday. Which numbers should we use, observed or adjusted mortality? There is a big difference here. If we use the adjusted mortality, then the low salinity sites have a lower release mortality than the high salinity sites, which is opposite the trend that was discussed in the paper. What do you guys think? Hey guys, Chris, Doug, don't see anything wrong with using the adjusted values. Not sure how we would use model given the absence predictor info from MRFSS, but if you have a way to do this, then okay. The wild fluctuations in results across the various studies leaves one uncertain of an appropriate measure. It looks like there was no pen/handling mortality in the more marine waters, but he states cooler water temperatures for those workups, so what to do? We don't know. The variability in all these mortality studies is incredible, so whatever we pick will most likely be wrong. I would recommend going with a range of values. That sounds like a compromise, but I have to confess something. Often when folks question me in a persistent manner regarding an estimate, I'll end up asking them, well, what do you think the number should be? So, to answer my own question, I believe mortality lies somewhere in the range of 10% to 15%. Any project that is subject to the limitations of those that he had to deal with will always be subject to question, especially when the results could have such an impact while assessing spotted sea trout stocks. Maybe an issue paper would be a good idea. Of course, 3% still looks pretty good. Hello, everyone. If we accept the theory that sea trout caught in high salinity areas survive better than those caught in low salinity areas, then we contradict that theory if we use the adjusted mortality. We can't separate out which fish were caught from which month without the raw data. It seems reasonable to think that there may be regional differences in release mortality, perhaps due to salinity. Therefore, I propose that we use the observed mortality because the trend seen there makes sense with the general theory that fish undergo additional stress in low salinity. I'm not saying these are correct, but we have to choose something and be able to defend it if questioned on it. What is your vote? Doug has a dream, and it ain't a single flat rate. We're going to look at what we can do with the two rates in the morning. Back at y'all soon. If we put the 19.4% on the table, folks will flip out. They'll tell you that there is no way that one out of five fish they release dies. Might be worth a try. Chris conducted the analysis this morning. The results look very credible. Getting back to the analysis, the overall value seems reasonable to me, but it's up to you guys. This sounds like a good way to come up with a better estimate to me. I'm making my vote for using 9.8%.
And I'm no rocket scientist, but a percentage is easy to figure. Fifth graders do it on the blackboard every day. And you look at it and ask her, how did she derive them numbers? And she said, oh, it's complicated. No, it's not. Took 22 years of data and used the years that she wanted to come up with the numbers she wanted. That's what you're fighting as well. And that's the state employed people giving information to an advisory board. That's a little bit like stacking the deck.
Overfishing, is it that some of these fish, there's not as many of them in the water?
They put it all together, mortality, for what you're killing, and then what's going to come back.
And it's all a number they pick out of the hat. Number.
Marine Fisheries Commission sanctioned striped bass slaughter. Anglers set to seek relief in the General Assembly. Essentially, all recreational comments requested permanently closing the striped bass trawler fishery and to replace it with a hook and line commercial fishery. The waste was universally condemned during the public comment session, but the commercially dominated Marine Fishery Commission voted 6-2 to allow the practice to continue. Commissioners Anna Beckwith and Matt Curran were the dissenting votes. This utter disregard will continue until the makeup of the Marine Fishery Commission better represents the citizens of North Carolina, which is a goal of CCA North Carolina.
Dr. Daniel, you and your staff at the North Carolina Division of Marine Fisheries are charged with obeying all the state statutes of the state of North Carolina. The Marine Fisheries Commission has also taken an oath before they can serve to support those same statutes. Fisheries Reform Act of 1997 is obviously state statute now, and you support that, you know, very fervently. If there are to be other statutes as they come along, whether it's game fish or the menhaden reduction fishery or anything else that comes into state statute and becomes state law, you will support those state statutes just as you have other statutes in the past. Is that correct?
I don't see any difference between one statute or another. I mean, my responsibility is to enact the statutes that are handed down by the General Assembly. We take that job very seriously. So whatever changes are to come in this General Assembly and in this upcoming sessions, we will implement those recommendations or requirements just like we have any other.
Where did the game fish bill come from?
The game fish bill has been over the last 4 or 5 years presented in the House by somebody who they could find. You know, they'll go to some inland person, maybe in Raleigh.
They have hired the longest sitting Republican House member in the state of North Carolina, Harold Brubaker. They hired him out of the General Assembly for Lord only knows how much money as their head lobbyist.
Game fish bill front and center. Parker Poe, led by Bruce Thompson and Brubaker and Associates, led by former House Speaker Harold Brubaker, are the registered lobbyists for CCANC this session. Their teams are already hard at work on our efforts to obtain game fish designation for red drum, spotted sea trout, and striped bass. House Speaker Tom Tillis has directed Representatives Tom Murray and Representative Tim Moffitt to lead the game fish efforts in the North Carolina House. Through their leadership, we have been contacting both House and Senate members to gauge their support and enlist bill sponsors in both chambers.
Bill, what can you tell us about the game fish status bill?
I haven't talked to the two or three representatives that I think will probably try to run that bill. I think that's one of those things that you just need to wait and see if they're going to do it, because they have to find the support for it in order to do it. And
would you say those representatives from the East, where are they from?
No, they're not. In fact, one of them is from the middle of the state, and I think the other one is up from the mountains.
Crowden Riley, that has never stepped foot down here in this sound, is going to tell you how you're going to live and work. Anything in the country, doctors govern doctrine, dentists govern dentists, lawyers govern lawyers, politicians govern fishermen. Because we don't have a degree and we don't know anything, according to the ones with degrees.
I want to thank everybody for being here today. Just a couple of house rules that you need to know.
One, I know there's a lot of passion behind this issue, whether it be from the commercial side or from the sportsman side. We're all aware of the emails, and we're all aware this has been an ongoing issue for many years. I would ask that everyone that addresses the group today be polite and respectful.
As we all know, this is a very contentious. These are very contentious issues, and they pit one user group against another, and that's unfortunate. What I would tell anybody that asked is that what we need to do is manage for sustainability. We need to manage for a sustainable harvest.
My name is Jerry Schill of Perfection, North Carolina. It's a crossroads near Cove City in Craven County. I know what it's like to participate in contentious debate on fish issues and have done my share in this building, especially in the 90s during the discussions on the Fisheries Reform Act, which was signed by Governor Jim Hunt in 1997. Prior to that debate, however, there were a couple of notable battles here in the General Assembly. The first began with a press conference in the Legislative Building by former Representative Billy Richardson. Members of the Coastal Conservation Association walked in with him. He introduced a bill that would have allowed for a non-binding ballot referendum on a net ban. The bill died in the Rules Committee, but I mention it to you so you understand why there is some earned paranoia by commercial fishermen. In other words, there's been talk of a net ban in this General Assembly prompted by the CCA.
Next, we have Representative Tom Murray come to actually go through the bill with everybody.
Thank you, Rosetta Bell. I appreciate your willingness to chair this, and I appreciate the attendance of everybody. I think we generated a fair amount of interest in this legislation, as it does every time it gets brought up, and that is the primary reason why I decided to engage in the negotiation on this legislation. It's an issue that continually presents itself before the legislature, and eventually recreational fishermen will get game fish status. It's going to happen in the state of North Carolina. And so my goal was to try to represent a negotiation and get a balanced solution to issues that present itself to the fisheries, and not just as one user group is an interest on game fish status, but what can we do to make sure that we have a vibrant commercial fishing industry in North Carolina as well. And as one legislator told me who's interested in this issue, he said, Tom, if you'll just wait 10 years, if you'll just wait 10 years, there won't be a commercial fishing industry, and this issue will just go away.
Even a few years earlier, in 1988, I received a newspaper article from Florida written by a sports writer with the headline, Good News, Redfish is Now Game Fish, along with this comment by the sports writer, Yes, friends. Let's continue to make commercial fishermen the endangered species. And you can bet your last dollar that no one will rally round to save that species, unquote. Game fish in Florida was supported by the Florida Conservation Association and fully supported a net ban a few years later. Point being, paranoia is justified.
CCA Fisheries Economic Development Act, and that's what the CCA has called it. And their words here say that the bill would help end overfishing.
And do you know who kills more fish a year than the commercial or the charter fishery put together? Recreational anglers.
A fisherman was going out there catching, you know, they were catching 100, 200 fish per person, and throwing them back and keeping four. And so the regular recreational fishermen like you and me, not CCA, they said, man, I wish we could keep more fish. You know, and so I made a motion at last meeting. I said, you know what, I talked to people and they want more fish. I make a motion that we raise this fish from four to eight. Oh, no, we can't do that. They're fishing for records. These other people were feeding their family and enjoying it, you know. Why kill it? Why catch 100 fish and you can only keep four? Look what you're doing. 25% of that, 30, say 40% of that. Look how many fish you killed doing that. Said they'd be better off to catch eight, go home.
And the majority of the introduced initiative, and I mean a vast majority, has come from the commercial, the two or three commercial seats on there. because we all go fishing. Yet these supposed, I don't know whether you would call them conservationists, environmentalists, I don't care. They're just special interests. They defeat it every time. Every time. Do you know why? Because they try to create a friction. They try to create, you know, like shoving two opposite ends of a magnet together, you know what I mean? I'm just about there, and then, you know, and that's what they try to do. They don't want to reconcile the difference between users because that takes their power play.
A handful of people wanting it all for themselves and nobody else gets any. That's what it boils down to. And unless they stand up and, as a consumer, say we want our share of it, nobody's going to speak for them. They're going to let the very few have it all, just like what happens in every other thing. They got the kingpins and everybody else is under or below. They're the only ones can have.
It's not about taking fish from one user group to the other. It's about remanaging the way we do this so that our fish will be more numerous in the water, bigger fish. We're not taking fish away from anyone. We're putting it on the same level as the view from the top, the light, Cape Hatteras light. It's always there. It's protected. But to use it, you've got to go see it yourself.
Thank you.
The consumer would no longer be able to go to a store or a restaurant and purchase those three fish. That's what that means.
Mm-hmm. So where do they go?
Commercially and revenue producing, they would still be caught commercially by guides and by captains. So that goes back to that what I said earlier. It's all commercial. If they don't want them to be caught, then nobody gets to catch them. Nobody. I mean, zero. If that's the way they want it, then I'll agree. I'll say sure. If there's a reason behind it because of the stock, but there's not.
I mean, just think about this. You're going to give a few all this resource and take away from the rest of North Carolina giving access to? I mean, how about equal rights and all these other crowds that talk about this stuff? It's like, wait a second here.
My name is Jess Hawkins. I was born, raised, and currently live in northeastern North Carolina. I worked my 30-year professional career as a public servant for the North Carolina Division of Marine Fisheries as a fisheries biologist and a manager. While I'm proud to be called a North Carolinian, I am deeply disturbed and even angry that my state is considering allocating a public trust natural resource to a small proportion of North Carolina's population when there is no scientific or conservation reason and questionable economic benefit to do so, and in the thoughts of many people is unjust and unfair.
You know, a lot of people 10 or 15 years ago felt like, oh, they're just trying to get theirs. No, they don't want theirs. They want all of ours.
This is about that if you give me that resource because I own a $60,000 Escalade and drive a $100,000 boat, then I'm going to spend more money going after these fish so I'm worth more.
Good afternoon. My name is Chuck Lockridge. I'm a resident of Parker's Island, a CCA state board member. I'd like to address one thing, and that is that the state of North Carolina, by default, has to manage all of our public trust resources, whether they're human, natural, or fiscal. All of our resources that are there for the state to manage, we've got to manage them properly. You can sit back all day long and talk to folks about that. How to manage a public trust resource. But the bottom line is the state by default must manage these public trust resources to provide the highest total economic return to the state of North Carolina and the taxpayers therein. If we do not do that, we have provided either a direct or an indirect subsidy to whichever user group is not providing that highest total economic return.
So they say that, hey, if that guy driving from the western part of the state is coming here to the coast and spend 5 days, he's got to stop at the liquor store, buy $1,000 worth of liquor, he's got to stop somewhere else and maybe get a speeding ticket, and that's all because that fish is more important to him, or not more important, that he's worth more.
Would it give that industry a monopoly?
No, we give 100% of the resource to one user group. You can call that what you want. Selfish. And there's no science behind it. That's the thing. I mean, that's the group that's catching 70% of the fish, want 100% of the fish. Which is, like I say, once you explain that to people in Raleigh, they just say there's no reason for this bill. But people that are elected are getting paid to push this bill. So they're pushing it. I don't have any other way to put it.
So let's get on to the game fish portion of 983. There is no biological evidence that supports game fish. There is absolutely no data that opposes it. This is not a biological bill. So all of the biological data, all of the biological pie charts and bar graphs do not apply to this bill. This is an economic bill, the Marine Economic Development Act. It will be heard in Commerce in the House and most likely will pass to the Senate and be heard in Commerce there. This is not an economic, I mean, this is an economic bill, so it's not biology that's driving this.
And it's control. It's all about power. The person that controls it, it's no different than money. It's a commodity. Whether it's grain or gold or coal or natural gas or petroleum, or it doesn't matter what it is. When you control it and it's right there in your fist, that's money in the bank.
I want to remind you now that there are seven states, Texas, Louisiana, Mississippi, Alabama, Florida, Georgia, and South Carolina, that have all already gone down the path that we're on today. As we go down this path, we've yet to see any one of those seven states who are all led by good, fiscally conservative, Christian Republican governors. If you think any one of those governors, the likes of Rick Perry and Bobby Jindal, would basically do something that would harm their state economically, I think you're wrong. Absolutely wrong. They know the economics of what game fish can do. They know the economics of what's good for their state. So it's no doubt that this is the way North Carolina should go, and we should be the eighth state to embrace this.
We know that right now only 149 people caught and sold more than $2,000 worth of these three fish in inland waters in North Carolina last year from DMF trip tickets. But that's not an aberration. In other words, it's not because of rules, regulation, or whatever that this is a small number of people. In 1976, an individual named Connie Purvis wrote for the DMS a report on the Pamlico Sound. And when they got to Red Drum, it said the following. Red Drum are not considered to be of great importance as a commercial fish, but are highly regarded as a recreational fish. That was written 40 years ago.
Saying, well, you guys only catch like a few percentages, so why does it matter? Well, if we only catch a few percent, why do you need it?
I personally catch 12 to 15% of my income is from them. That 12%, 15%, I can pay my mortgage with that for the whole year. So I don't think there's anybody in this crowd that thinks they could have part of their income that pays their mortgage for a year taken away from them and still make it. I don't care what you make or where you live.
That bothers me because of the history of our state with your industry. And so I wanted to try to address this in a way that seemed fair and balanced. So in part one, we have the designation of coastal game fish. We have the three species that we are designating in addition to mitigation payments for anyone who experiences any losses.
They say that it would compensate the commercial fishermen money.
Hey, so we're going to take your, I mean, that's just a slap in the face, that's like a few other words. I mean, it's just, yeah, we're going to take you, hey, well, yeah, we'll give you a few dollars here. But how about that guy, how about that person that likes to eat that fish? He don't get it no more. You go pay that fisherman, but how about the consumers? I mean, that's just, that shows you the arrogance. I'm going to take your livelihood, but I'll pay you for a couple years.
I am glad this bill compensates those individuals who may have to give up income. It reminds me of what my family received when we had to give up raising tobacco.
I would like to address the issue of financial support for commercial fishermen in this bill. Again, I cannot speak currently for fishermen, but when I was approached with a suggestion like payments to fishermen, if the state bans a particular gear, bans nets, or any other scheme, it was simply this: the commercial fishing families are not for sale.
I'm not born and raised that way as far as wanting somebody's livelihood going, or I mean, I just don't understand it. And a lot of us don't. Losing that access and freedom of giving that thing, that's far more important than any dollar for me.
Now, we have those figures, and you presented those to the Marine Legislative Study Commission up in Raleigh. Now, those figures are basically going to vary from year to year. But if you will, tell us about which figure is the higher and the ones that you use for comparison in Raleigh.
The higher overall value was the recreational fishery. For the most recent time frame, it was about $1.7 billion, I believe, and the commercial fishing value was around $300 million.
Reallocating these resources for recreational fishermen only deny consumers and people that do not own a boat or can get to the water access to that public trust resource. There seems to be no reason to take such an action besides selfishness and greed. Instead, I envision a state that will continue to allow its citizens access to these fish resources as long as those resources are not endangered, whether it be through hook and line fishing, being caught by commercial fishermen, being bought at a retail fish market, or eaten at a restaurant.
I got a copy.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Representatives, thank you. My name is Warren Judge. I'm chairman of the Dare County Board of Commissioners. We're blessed in Dare County to have an abundant fishing industry. This is an economic question. And being on the ground in Dare County, it smacks of taking fish from one sector to another. It's about jobs. In this legislature, we've heard for the last several years about economic stimulus and creating jobs. Let's not lose the jobs we have. We appreciate everybody that fishes in the sea. They're our farmers. And we need to keep them working. And we need to keep, these are backbone of America. These are hardworking men and women, families, children to raise. You can't take a public trust resource, take it from somebody, give it to somebody else.
Thank you for allowing me the opportunity to speak. I'm Tim Hergenrader from Pamlico County. I urge you to vote for HB 983. Red drums, specks, and estuarine striped bass are worth more to the state of North Carolina as a recreational fishery than a commercial fishery. Of that, there is no question, no doubt. Manage them as such. We already manage all our fish and wildlife populations in the state, except our inshore saltwater fishes, for the benefit of all our citizens, and they are not for sale. That is the American model. Passage of this bill will result in increased populations of the three fish. When that happens, fishermen will come to the coast. When they do, they will spend a lot of money. This bill fits your pledge to increase jobs and improve the economy. Fits it to a T. And best of all, it won't cost the taxpayers one red cent. Thank you for your time and your service to our state.
Now CCA comes to a cash-strapped legislature proclaiming windfalls await. The clouds will part, and it's going to rain $100 bills. All legislators need to do is allocate the CCA's clients and membership highly coveted state public resource accounts. Oh, and the money to pay for all this comes from where? You guessed it. Picked from the pockets of the very public trust stakeholders themselves. As additional license fees.
I believe the positive economic impact the supporters of this bill espouse are an ill-conceived pipe dream. There is no evidence to support the statement that there will be an influx of new recreational fishermen to North Carolina just because these fish receive game fish status. There is a negative economic impact to those that make their living from our waters. And that should weigh more heavily on your minds, especially during these challenging times.
I pack seafood for local fellas. I've got one man, a commercial fisherman, is going to do enough to feed his family, support his people. This boy, he's had a tough time of it all winter. hadn't caught a lot of oysters, didn't really get the gist of catching a speckled trout, but striped bass come around. He come to me, he sold almost $700 worth of striped bass that week. He got his check on Friday. He was so happy. His new young baby went to the mama's house as a babysitter, and he took his girl to the restaurant. He took her to the same restaurant that I sold them striped bass to. Them striped bass, he give the restaurant the money that the restaurant bought them striped bass from me. That money made a complete little circle inside of 2 miles in Pamlico County. That's real economics, and it's real important, and it involves real people. That mirror lure that these guys, these recreational fishermen go and buy, it's manufactured in China. It's not manufactured in Pamlico County like that striped bass was. So that money is now going to China. We're going to have to spend more money getting seafood from China. All our dollars are going overseas, and what do we got? A bunch of recreational fishermen. This is about money. Let's keep the money here. Let's keep it local and support our people that live there every day, not somebody who might live from away and come down and might spend money. They could do the same thing with a $10 cane pole and a bucket of minnows. Thank you all.
And now I don't know why we're here. I mean, fishery management is working, and now all of a sudden we want to just change the rules because things didn't work out exactly the way one group wanted it to. Do your best. Vote against it. Thank you.
According to the population of North Carolina in 2010, there were 9,535,483 people. According to the license data collected by DMF, there are a total of 439,251 in and out of state licenses issued. This is roughly about 3 to 4% of our state population. In essence, if this bill passes, less than 5% of people will have access to these wild-caught species of fish. So how can a legislature allow a group of individuals to push for making these fish game fish and take them from all the consumers in North Carolina? Thank you.
I feel like it is about jobs, it is about finances, it is about choosing winners and losers, but more than that, it is about limiting the freedom of choice and the, all kinds of freedoms of individual people, and I see that as a very wrong thing to do. Instead of protecting our people and their rights, we are squeezing them. Is that what we want to be doing? I think we need to rethink this.
Between the economy, lack of beach access, lack of rational solutions to our highway problems, and now, of course, you can add this elitist agenda aiming to take one of the last reasons for people to come to the coast, which is fresh local seafood. The question is, how many nails does it take to nail the coffin shut?
As important as this is to me, the supporters of this bill say that it's not important to our state. These same people are asking our state to spend $1 million of taxpayers' money to pay us not to catch these fish. Let me say this again. They're asking you to pay us to quit providing revenue to our state. Now, this does not sound like a sound economic plan to me.
I come here today to fight for my livelihood. My family and I should not be financially compromised simply to support another luxurious coastal excursion, vacation, or sport.
The reason I'm here today is my daughter-in-law wanted to be here, and she couldn't because she's a counselor at the Craven County Public Schools, and she had to work today. So I'm going to read a letter from her. My name is Jessica Sadler Padilla. I am the wife, the daughter, and the sister of a commercial fisherman. We are all scared that there is something to be lost. However, there is something that has already been lost. The human component of this equation has been overlooked.
Game fish is an antiquated policy of allocating resources to a single user group and to the exclusion of all others. It creates very narrowly defined target, a single fish species, which the result is always the same: exploitation of native stocks beyond their ability to reproduce and maintain the population.
We have to do something different. If we continue to do the same thing over and over again, we shouldn't expect any kind of a change. This is about value. Where do these fish offer the greatest value? It's a public resource. And the intent is to, it is a public resource. I don't deny that, it's a public resource. But the intent of this is to find the place where these fish can be used and offer their greatest value. Therefore, I strongly support House Bill 983. Thank you.
Are discriminated against due to the fact of their economic standing. Just because my boat's not $60,000, I'm looked upon while wading around in the water with gill nets on the back of my boat, trying to make a mere living to stay off of any assistance program and to pay my own way. And that's what every one of these commercial fishermen are here to do today. Thank you.
I learned a lot of very hard lessons those summers. I learned the value of a dollar, and I learned that commercial fishing is hard work. But it makes me so proud of our commercial fishermen in eastern North Carolina.
These same people would have you believe that if you pay us to quit providing revenue to our state, that droves of recreational fishermen are going to flock here and spend their money. Where are these fishermen who refuse to fish in North Carolina until we pass a game fish bill?
Florida residents fell prey to the same deceptive tactics and contrived ploys of CCA in 1994, resulting in the banning of fishermen's nets.
HB 983 will require commercial fishermen to discard every game fish we catch, dead or alive. This would result in tons of dead discards that will be deducted from the share of seafood that consumers currently enjoy before being allocated to the recreational sector. Is there any amount of revenue to the state that would justify this kind of waste and cruelty? Would you support a law that required hunters to discard wounded animals because it might raise some money?
A great portion of North Carolina's present legislature is fundamentally uninformed on this topic of debate, making them blindly vulnerable to the stealth intentions of the game fishermen. These intentions being the satisfaction of fulfilling their own selfishness, all the while somewhat mirroring the practice of extreme environmentalism.
What I want to hear from especially the commercial fishing industry are state-specific issues that can be mitigated through this type of legislation to keep your industry vibrant, with the full knowledge that game fish is on the table. And eventually, you could get a game fish status with no commercial input, and that would bother me as a legislator if it wasn't a balanced piece of legislation.
On March the 1st, at a meeting in Wanchese, Representative Tom Murray told fishermen they needed to reinvent themselves. I respectfully contend that Representative Murray should make that suggestion to the Coastal Conservation Association.
Recreational angling is not simply about catching a bag limit. It's about perception, abundance, and the experience. Gamefish management enhances these qualities that attract people to the coast. This is different than managing for maximum sustainable harvest. Recreational fishermen value and pay to experience more fish left in the water.
In 2008, the same three fish had a bill come up about game fish. It didn't pass. I have a news flash. The recreational fishermen did not lose any income. They didn't commit suicide. They didn't sell their boats or their fishing gear. They didn't stop fishing or coming to the coast. They didn't buy golf clubs or tennis rackets and join a country club. And all the recreational support industry did not lose income. Life went on just as before, spending money, coming to the coast, going fishing and having fun. I believe that the natural resources are put here by an authority much greater than we. And I challenge you to refer to your Constitution, and before you take up any legislation, make sure that the authority is given to you in there. Thank you.
I have trouble sleeping nights worrying about what's going to happen. I'm on a marine fisheries meeting. I hear a lot of things said up here. But you know what? A lot of things you're hearing is not the truth. That's why we have to be real careful. But one day we're going to have to stand up for ourselves, what we've done and what we've said and where we are. The commercial fishing in North Carolina is in terrible condition. And we need help. And you think you're trying to get more jobs. We need to secure the jobs that we have right now. I would love to sit down. I could talk to you for hours about what we need to do. What we need to do is we need to come up here and see you. We didn't tell you what we need, where we need to go, what we need to do. We need to bring them up here, come up here and tell you what kind of fish we catch. Well, what kind of net? Y'all know nothing about what we do. And it's what it is. You know, what's the deal? And I say, my God, why didn't somebody call me? Why didn't somebody ask me what we need to do and how do we kind of react to this? Not one call. All we want is you. We want our voice to be heard. Our voice is not being heard up here. Would you please listen to us? We need help. We're worth something. My daughter, last week, she was a freshman at Asbury. She was a teacher of the year. We are good people. We're not bad people.
They didn't get the game fish bill. So what happened? He got put in the Marine Fishery Commission.
If the main proponent of that legislation is now on the Marine Fisheries Commission,
correct,
can they not just regulate it from there, what they wanted to do with that bill?
In a roundabout way, yes.
If you got a majority, it's about the votes.
So they can make regulations like that?
Oh, yeah, okay, yeah.
And but so that is now done and over with?
It's done and, well, yes and no. We have on the agenda is for this coming, we're going to be talking about shrimp. They want us to have a 40% reduction. This can be, it's going to be discussed in our next meeting.
Okay.
And they're going to put a limit on striped mullets. It's coming up in our next meeting. And then we're going to talk about American shad. There's nothing wrong with American shad. We're going to talk about this. I just got it yesterday. River herring.
It got people all around this coast and inland to say, you know what? Damn, they already catch 90% of them. They want the rest of it? To hell with that. And so that's what got everybody going. And them legislators knew that it was a sticky thing. So they said, you know what? It's going to die here in the Senate. And it might die in the House, I ain't sure. And so therefore, they said, well, you know what? Well, it died and all this. Y'all did a good effort. Here, Chuck, we'll put you on the Marine Fishery Commission. Because you couldn't have been no damn stupider to say.
Is it not really clear exactly where these issues are coming from to be added to the agenda? Like, who's proposing these things?
Well, you got Chuck Lottridge. He used to be the water user in the CCA. You got Joe Schutz. They're in Anna Bekovich.
And there's the commission members.
Yeah, all commission.
Describe for me the relationship between the CCA and the Department of Marine Fisheries and what their roles
same.
Are.
I mean, it's one and the same. Five of the CCA members on the Marine Fisheries Commission.
Well, we've been complaining for years that it's a stacked deck. The board is stacked, one against us.
Mm-hmm. But for the governor of North Carolina to appoint Chuck Lothridge, who won the most outspoken person on this game fish bill, to the Division of Marine, Marine Fishery Commission, I have never had a slap in my face or poke in my eye any better than that.
Does he do any research into this? Does he even have a clue where Wanchese, North Carolina is? Or Oregon Inlet? Or what's here? What we do? How we do it? What we put up with? Is he looking to provide jobs for this great state of North Carolina at the rate they're putting us out of business?
I don't know how we can correct the imbalance on the Marine Fisheries Commission, if get back to that, other than going to the Department of Agriculture. I think that would be a great step for commercial and charter headboats in North Carolina. The farmers don't have the gardeners writing their regulations for them, and we do. As fishermen, we do. We have the people that don't do it for a living, that are not in industry, writing the regulation that I have to live by.
In other words, has he ever been to any of these meetings and sit there and listen to who he's paying give information, and people sitting right there tell him it's wrong? And they know it's wrong, given it. Well, how can you run the program? How can you even run the state like this? It's crooked.
I mean, fishing's important. Yeah, we got a lot of things in our state that goes on. But I can tell you one thing, you know, it's what makes our communities in eastern North Carolina and all down the coast.
The saddest part isn't what I can or can't do, but the years of knowledge that's been handed down to me from brothers, sisters, uncles, people I've been fortunate enough to work with, and my son. I don't have the opportunity for him to be the best. They're not going to let him. And he's already, at 18, better than most. And I could really educate him and train him to be one of the best, and we won't have that opportunity. That's what bothers me. My 35 years of experience, I don't get to hand to him to where he can do it with ease. They don't nail and do that. That's sad.
This one's for the lonely, the ones that seek and find, only to be let down time after time. This one's for the torn down, the experts at the fall. Come on, friends, get up now, you're not alone at all. Oh, 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 oh. Oh, 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 oh. And this part was for her, and this part was for her. This part was for her, does she remember?
Thank you.